5:30, but that is not happening. But so Chief, tell us a little bit about your background, and for anybody that is visiting and doesn't know, you know, what you stumbled across. My name is Angela Williams Graves. I am the Super Ward 7 council member for the city of Norfolk. I have with me Councilwoman Andrea McClellan, who is the Super Ward 6 representative for the city of Norfolk, and we together represent the entire city of Norfolk. And so we have on the phone, who we're trying to get live, our Chief of Police, Chief Larry Boone. And he's been with the city of Norfolk for a few decades. And although he doesn't look past 18, right? But but he's been here for a couple of decades, and he is a police chief who has actually moved up in rank and now serves as the police chief for the city of Norfolk, and has been the police chief for what, Chief, the last 4 years or 5 years?
It'll be 5 years in December.
Okay. All right. 5 years in December. So tell us a little bit about your background and about yourself. You have quite a unique story, if I recall correctly.
So I'm originally from New Brunswick, New Jersey, from a single parent household. My mother had me at the age of 16. And shortly after that, she had my two brothers. We grew up in public housing, and everybody's familiar with, well, most folks that are familiar with public housing, you have an idea how challenging that can be. And I'm here to say I have met everything that public housing has to offer by way of poverty, by way of unemployment, under education, homelessness, and for the most part, you know, folks that lived in my community live day to day trying to do the very best that they can to survive. As far as relations with police, I don't recall any officer friendlies. I do recall the police, and generally, when they came in my neighborhood, they were taking someone to jail, and quite frequently, it was a conflict, and it was bloody in most cases. Growing up, having witnessed a lot of that activity, I was definitely afraid of police. I pinched myself every time I'm doing one of these speaking engagements, and I have to shake my head to realize that I'm actually the chief of police, because nothing about my background would indicate that. I didn't always get along with the police, which is why there were times I spent some nights in jail as a juvenile. Mm-hmm. And because of my ability to play sports, my coaches and mentors, they convinced my mother to move me south to a small town in Northampton County, North Carolina. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I always say the me I see is the me I'll be. Once I moved to North Carolina, I realized my full potential, and I was fortunate enough to receive an athletic scholarship. And from that scholarship, I went on to win two national championships for football. And I subsequently joined the police department, and I decided to start taking the test for rank just 16 years ago. And I did so well in the process that I went from officer to chief in a very, very short period of time.
Hey, Chief, what was it that made you want to join? I mean, after like not having great interactions with the police and spending time in jail, what made you decide that that was what you wanted to do? Because it seems like that would have been just the opposite, or maybe you would have thought, I want to be a lawyer, I want to be a judge, or, you know, something completely out of the law enforcement category.
That's a good question. I knew graduating from college, I wanted to be part of a team. You know, I was used to a teamwork environment. I wanted to join something that required a uniform. And part of that decision-making process, there was a guy a couple years older than me, had joined the Atlanta Police Department. And he kind of intrigued me, you know, with the idea of becoming a police officer. And at first, I wanted nothing to do with it. Mm-hmm. But I recall for the first time seeing an African-American police officer for the first time. And that image was so powerful to me that I knew right then that that's something I wanted to do. So I joined the Norfolk Police Department. I recall going to the old arena, and there were 40 positions, and about 7 people showed up for those 40 positions. And I was fortunate enough to be one of the 40. Mike Goldsmith was part of my academy as well. And it's interesting, you know, in our friends, and we come from completely different backgrounds. Mm-hmm. I went to private school, and I went to public school, and, you know, I went to one of those schools where all the pages were always in the book. Went to the 1, 2, 3, 12, 13, 23. And then on top of that, we had to share the book. But, you know, one of the things I started embracing when I started taking the test and started doing rather well, I used to be somewhat reluctant to share my background. I was afraid of being ostracized or criticized or being placed in a corner. Mm-hmm. So I did not share that information for a very long time, because I allowed people to believe what they saw in me. They saw in me an individual that probably grew up in a class with both parents and knew no idea what the public housing setting was. But at some point, I recognized that I needed to be true to myself, because there's a lot of Larry out here in Norfolk. And right. they need to know that, you know, regardless of their stage in life, that anything's possible.
Right. Well, you know what? That's very true. I think a lot of times people get caught up in not being true to themselves, and they get caught up in like what they feel like people want to hear and see. And so kudos to you for, acknowledging your background and talking about your story and telling your story, because you're right. There are so many other people who are just like you, and they may have never thought that they could be anything if they had never heard your story. So I'm pretty sure that there are people who you will never meet or shake their hand or know about, whose lives have been impacted by you telling your story. And I believe that all of the experiences that we have had, those that we're responsible for and those that we're not responsible for, because you can't control where you were raised and what environment you were raised in, make us who we are. And so everything that you went through and all that you you had to deal with has served to make you a great police chief. So in talking about that, let's talk a little bit about the leadership in the police department. I know you wanted to talk to us a little bit about some of the things that you all do about crime reduction, and some of the community outreach efforts that your department does. And so people can fully understand or have a better understanding of your philosophy as a leader.
So first and foremost, I visit every recruit class and I allow them to develop opinions about who I am as a police chief and as a person. And when I share with them the story I just shared with you, a lot of them are so surprised. They would have never expected that. And the reason I share that story with them is because a lot, some of them, not a lot, but some of them will be patrolling areas in which I grew up in, and I want to instill upon them that it's important that we allow people to make mistakes, particularly our young African American men. Sometimes they need 2 and 3 mistakes. Mm-hmm. I was afforded 3 mistakes, and I'm telling you, if I had not been provided an opportunity to get that second and third chance, I wouldn't be here today. So I stress to my officers that, you know, our young men, there's a lot of them, they're very talented. They just need a break. Don't always reach for your handcuffs the first time you're in the face with them, because they need that second and third break. So I say all that to say we are very, very engaged in the community.
I think, Chief, hold on 1 second. Unmute yourself. I'm hearing a vibration, so you might have sound. If you unmute yourself, let's see if that works.
No. No such luck.
I know, right? Okay, I got you back on speaker.
That's driving me crazy.
All right. I know. It's all good. We'll make it work.
Yeah. All right. So we try to work in a philosophy of being authentic and engaging with our community. One of the things I'm very proud of is the women and men of this department. They've embraced my philosophy. And we go into these communities and we try our very darnest to win trust. Mm-hmm. We are going to be highlighted next month in a international magazine called the Police Chief Magazine. And the city of Norfolk once again will be front and center with respect to their police department. And that article is going to cover our programs. Our programs, we deal with young folks from 5 to grad. And I'm very excited about that particular award.
Cool. And what is this? What is the magazine again? The publication?
It's called the Police Chief Magazine.
Okay. All right. Cool beans.
It's an international magazine that's been around a very, very long time. It's published by IACP, International Association of Chief of Police.
Okay. All right. Cool beans.
I won't get into all our programs. We have 20 to 25 programs, but you know, we try our best to do our youth. We do that through our mentoring program, mm-hmm. in which we interface with a kindergarten that may have reading challenges, mm-hmm. and we stick with that individual for a whole school year. And subsequently, at the end of the school year, their reading has improved, and we've developed a partnership that we didn't have originally. And we've been involved in this program for 6 years.
So, you know what? That's very interesting, because one of the questions that we had was about the mentoring program. Do you all have a middle and high school student do you have a mentoring program for middle and high school students, like a police explorer post or something like that? That was one of the questions that was asked of us.
Yeah, I want to recognize one of our constituents. Let's see, it looks like Vashti and Tasha asked that question. So thank you for, and I think that they're online as well. So mm-hmm. can you talk about anything along those lines? I know you talked about the elementary school. Are we doing anything at the middle and high school levels?
So we have a program called True Teaching, Reaching, Understanding, and Educating. This program is truly one that my officers get on their own without senior leadership input. This is a good indication that they truly are embracing community policing. And this program is geared towards those young folks about to graduate, whether they're going into the working world or college or military. Our goal is to provide them with the means to get there.
Okay.
We have partnerships with the military, those that are going into the career world, as well as college representatives. And we teach them how to write a resume, teach them what is some of the services that they can. I think we're still trying to. Can you hear me?
I can't. Wait a minute. Hold on. Let me. Okay. Try that again, Chief. I cannot. No, I've got you on speaker, but I can't hear you on my laptop. But at least we don't have the. Can I hear you? Yes. No. No. Okay. All right. We'll go back to speakerphone. Gotta love technology.
Well, that was awesome on that phone. Thank you for your patience.
Yeah, definitely. Now, all right. We'll go back to speakerphone. We'll figure it out. Hey, Chief, I think I got you.
You think you got me?
Yes, yes, we can hear you. Yay.
Is that better?
Kudos to the PR team.
All right, well, don't go anywhere because it's liable to crash.
I know, don't go. Stay close so you can reach with the hook, right?
We've done cases, and you know, this is the first time we ran into some problems, but you know, we're here now, so let's make the best of it.
Good deal, good deal. So you were talking about the mentoring, the True program that you your team developed.
My team developed on their own, which is really, really something significant, because a lot of the programs started from this building, the leadership building. And when you have your officers starting to develop programs on their own, that's an indication that they are truly embracing your philosophy. So we have, I think we've done the program with all the high schools, and we're starting to do some repeats. We got this idea actually from, believe it or not, Councilman Riddick.
Okay.
At one council meeting, he said to then Chief Goldsmith, and I thought it was like, okay, you're really asking a lot of your police department to get people jobs, okay? But that's what he said one council meeting. He said, Chief, why don't your folks go out and find jobs for these young people? And I guess one of my officers must have heard that, and they took that idea and developed partnerships with Target, Walmart, the military, local colleges. And like I said, we've served over, I think it's been about 150 high schoolers, you know, that were able to either one, go into the job market, or two, go to college, or three, you know, go into the military with our assistance. And we also help them get summer jobs as well. One of the things I was working on before COVID was the idea of starting a cadet program with our high schools. I wanted to be able to surgically go into the community and recruit high schoolers that had an interest in law enforcement. They had to live in Norfolk. They had to be a senior that was willing and wanted to be a law enforcement officer. And we were going to hire them part-time, just like some of the other cities do, at the tune of $24,000 a year. And their job would simply be to do some of the lower hanging fruit that our patrol cars do right now. And once they turn 20 and a half, they would roll over into our police academy. And I think with the idea of them being with us in a temporary fashion, the idea of going into the police academy wouldn't be so daunting. It wouldn't be so overwhelming, and they would have a good opportunity to survive. But that was one of the things me and the city manager were talking about, but this virus has slowed a lot of things down. I want to go back to that because I think it's a good idea, one, to get folks from the city, two, to try to increase your diversity within the police department. And I'll speak a little bit on the diversity piece.
Yeah, talk to us about the diversity, Chief, because I understand that we have one of probably the most diverse police departments in the Commonwealth. So talk to us about that.
So we do. We are the most diverse police department in the state. And it's not just enough to be diverse. I think sometimes as African Americans, we get that one bone, so to speak, and we're satisfied. I want to be diverse and I want to be inclusive. And what that means is we've got an African American chief. We have one African American assistant chief. We have two or three African American captains. And not just African Americans, members of the LGBTQ plus community. My LGBTQ plus officers, they are loud and proud, and they want you to know who they are, and we celebrate their differences. So, you know, we have Hispanics in leadership positions, we have Asians, and we have a host of women. You know, diversity is not enough. We got to get away from just celebrating diversity. You got to have someone that's at the table, but inclusive as well. Inclusive means they have a voice. They have a voice to implement policy. And a lot of our policies are implemented by a host of different people. You know, we have a LGBTQ plus general order, a policy that says how we will interface with that community, because we had some issues a couple years ago by identifying someone by the wrong pronoun. We just don't want to offend anyone. I'm very, very proud of the women and men of this department. They've embraced a lot of our philosophies, our 21st century philosophies. That's going to make us a different police department, and we are a different police department. And I think when folks come here and see how we celebrate diversity and that we're authentic about it, not just one or two positions, as I said, we have folks throughout our rank and file that represents all walks of life. And I believe that's what make you a better organization. I think that when chaos comes to town, as it has in some cities through protests, I think if you have people from different backgrounds and folks that are able to absorb that energy through the protesters' grievances, we're better for it. And I've seen some of my officers absorb some things that was said to them that I wish it hadn't been said to them, but nonetheless, they absorbed it and they went to the next intersection and made it safe for the protesters to continue on. And these are white officers, black officers, males, females, all walks of life.
So Chief, you talked a little bit about the philosophy and what in being inclusive, and I know that the general perception of the police department in the Black community is that there's this, you know, this old boys club, this blue line wall thing or whatever it is, but how did you get the officers, the men and women who serve with you, to buy in to your philosophy of inclusiveness and not just, we're just going to be the law and order, you know, cops. We're just going to toe the line. How did you get them to really buy into that? And did you have to not threaten any of them, but like forcefully push them in order to help them to see the light?
So, you know, this occupation carries a lot of authority, okay? You have a lot of authority to take someone's liberty, you know, their ability to move, and freedom. And with that, you have to treat people with dignity and respect. One of the things I tell folks is I made over 1,300 arrests in my career, and I've only been complained of three times. And one of the reasons why is because I always spoke with people or to people with dignity and respect. And I've never had to hit anyone with a Kel light or any of that stuff, because I wanted to let the uniform and what came out of my mouth do the talking. And I also educate my recruits that every police department, I don't care where it is, has a history, okay? And whether that's history with the African-American community or whether it's with the LGBTQ community or Hispanic community, every police department, particularly in an urban setting, has a history. And you got to talk about that history. We talk about the slave patrol in our academy. We talk about Jim Crow. We talk about mass incarceration. And we talk about Norfolk 17 right here that happened here. All right. And we have, I forget the lady's name right now,
Dr. Newby Alexander?
No. One of the actual Norfolk 17.
Dr. Pat. Yes. She used to be a teacher at Maury High School.
Yes.
That's amazing.
She actually comes and speak to our academy, because what I want them to do and get an understanding that, you know, you have a macro sense of racial strife and you have a micro sense of racial strife right here in your own backyard. So when you interface with folks, particularly African Americans, if they meet you with suspicion, there's a reason for that. Okay, there's a long historical issues that have highlighted, you know, the issue with law enforcement and African Americans, and a lot of these folks are still living that remember some of these things. When you look at, you know, the right to vote, you know, I was looking at a documentary with a Congressman John Lewis, and I saw at the end of that bridge there were white policemen lined up with billy clubs and a host of African Americans trying to protest, okay, exercise their First Amendment rights. And I thought of Norfolk, okay, and how we allow them to do just that unfettered. You see what I'm saying? We allow them to exercise their First Amendment right unfettered. Although, again, I'll say I was so proud of my policemen, because some other protesters, not all of them, but some of them were not very nice and saying some awful things. And we saluted smartly, and we went to the next intersection and made it safe for them. And we've done that numbers of times.
So, Chief,
you have a hard job.
Yes, definitely. So you brought this up. You touched upon our past. You touched about on the fact that you've only had three complaints yourself, which is wonderful. We have questions about records of use of force. We've had questions about how far back we can go in those records, et cetera. And you've been pretty public about the idea of having a citizen review panel or some independent oversight. Could you talk a little bit about that and what your experience has been with that? I know that we're going to be anticipating that too. And then also there was a question that was posed as to why we couldn't go back for more years of records as we consider the past as well. Could you touch on those elements?
All right, so let's talk about use of force first. When an officer uses force, we have to self-report. And what I mean by that, and I don't care who you are, if you don't want to be arrested, it looks ugly. It just does, okay? If we have to grab someone by the shoulder to readjust them, to handcuff them, if we have to put their arms behind their back, and if they don't want to, if we have to point a taser or kick in the door, we have to self-report that. That's called a use of force report, which is why people say, okay, you have 400 use of force reports, okay? All those reports aren't physical in terms of hitting someone with a baton or hitting someone with an object or punching someone. A lot of times those are weaponless issues. Mm. Now, you got use of force reports, self-reporting that we have to document anytime we use it. And then over here, you have out of those 400 plus reports, you got 27 excessive force complaints. 27, that's what we average a year for the last 5 years. So out of that 400 self-reporting use of force, we have a very, very small fraction of people complaining that we've done something over the top. We average 27 excessive force complaints for the last 5 years. And I think people need to understand the differences. Now, having said that, I know there's room for opportunity for oversight, okay? I don't want you to take my word for it, and I get that, but I do want you to give me the benefit of the doubt to allow the investigation to go on. There's various models when it comes to police oversight. As I said in one of my Zoom conferences some time ago, you have the investigator type. That type is very expensive, and it generally looks like an individual who does not report to anyone, and he or she or it is able to investigate complaints.
Sorry, that's me. Sorry, I'm just trying to make sure I'm checking questions here. That's me. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay, all right. I thought it was me, but they're able to, you know, have full scope of the complaint and do the investigation of the citizen as well as the officer and make recommendation. That is the investigator model. As I said, it's somewhat costly. And then you have the review model, which is basically an oversight advisory model in which it's made up of volunteers and they look at complaints after the investigation has been completed by the police department. They are able to look at the complaint and vet that investigation and report out to the community. They don't have any ability to make recommendations though to the chief with respect to discipline. And then there's that third category, which is a blend of the last one and the second one, and it's a audit collaboration type model in which the citizen and police work hand in glove together and they come to a conclusion about the investigation and they have input with respect to the discipline that the chief will render. As I said some time ago, there's 18,000 police departments in the country. And when you talk about how many oversight panels exist, we're only talking about 160 to 180. So there, right now, there is not an appetite for oversight panels, but I suspect, you know, they're going to pick up vastly because of the environment we find ourselves in, and they're needed. I just think that, you know, you have to be careful in the type of model you select. These aren't cookie cutters. It has to be something that's unique for your city. And you don't want to put a model together that would benefit Chicago, okay? And, you know, something of that nature. But I met with the city manager today, and myself and Deputy City Manager Goldsmith and City Manager Chip Filer, we started the process of what that's going to look like. And I think there'll be some growing pains, but we're come to a compromise because this is what it's going to require, a compromise. And I think we'll have something that the citizens, one, will have input on, and two, that they can have some trust that it will work the way it was meant to work.
So Chief, I'm going to jump in and go with, I think there has been an appetite for citizen advisory committees. I think that has just been ignored, to be perfectly honest with you. I think there's been a lot of pushback from some of your counterparts who are probably not as transparent as you are, and don't come to the table with the same philosophy. And so I think there has been, over the course of time, residents and citizens wanting this. It's just been not widely accepted. And I do agree that I think that that is changing, and that will change. One of the things that we had a question about, and I'm trying to just scan here and see if I can find it, but it was a question about why aren't residents involved in the community relations development, and how can we support the police department when creating community policing events? How can citizens assist with inputs and ideas? And so I'm gonna pivot that a little bit and say that in the determination of how this police advisory board is put together, I think personally it needs to be more than you, the city manager, and the former chief of police, in terms of, you know, what it's going to look like and how it's going to get rolled out. I think that I don't know if it's a survey, I don't know if it's several Zoom calls, I don't know what it is, but I think that we need to have more citizen input in the formulation of the review board, because you want people to, I think, buy into what the board is going to be designed to do and how it's designed to do it. And you want people to trust the integrity of what comes out of the board, whatever their role is and whatever their end product is to the community. We don't want people to think that it was baked because two white guys and a black chief decided what this was gonna look like.
If I presented it that way, that was mighty clumsy of me.
Okay.
Because that's not how it's going to roll out. We are simply putting various models together.
Okay.
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 And we're gonna put it out there for public consumption.
Okay.
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 And we are just trying to put various models together. We're not saying model A, this is what we're going with. I mean, that wouldn't make any sense. Okay.
Okay.
We don't want to.
It's been done before, Chief.
right. We're putting various models together, and this is going to be community driven.
Okay.
Because once those models are put together, we're going to open it up to the public. Okay. By what model we go with and who wants to participate. We're not picking people. Okay. We're looking for folks that are a civic minded, community minded, and want to make that commitment, because it is a commitment.
Right.
All right. So I echo what you say, Ms. Graves. It won't just be the police chief and two white guys. I guess.
So here's what I would say about this. I think it is. I absolutely agree with Angela's comments here. And as I understand it, these are major time commitments for folks who are going to be on these types of panels, for sure. I think, Angela, we should stress that there be a subcommittee that we actually interview folks who are interested, because we don't typically do that for our boards and commissions. I would suggest we should. But Angela, maybe you and I can commit to try and convince our colleagues. I think this is really important that we get the right people on this, and it's not just for show.
And the other piece too, I would say, you know, given the time commitment. So one of the things that we have talked about with regards to like boards and commissions is the people who apply are generally of a retired age, or they are of a financial status where they don't necessarily have to work. So they have all this time available. So I would also like to find out how we could maybe legally add some age parameters, some gender parameters to this board, so we don't end up with a board that may not be reflective of the entire community. I don't know how we legally do that, but I think just like on some of our boards, you have to have a this and you have to have a that, and you have to have, you know, depending on what the board is, you have to have these subject matter experts. I think that we need to do that. And I think we also need to have a space for convicted felons on the board. I think we need to have a space for individuals. Generally, being a convicted felon may get you excluded from something, but I think having a convicted felon on the board, or two or three or whatever, is something that as people talk about policing, everybody's experience is different. Mine is the extent of being stopped for a traffic citation, okay, which is very different from somebody who, that's it. I don't want blue, you laugh, Chief, but I don't want blue lights behind me under any circumstances, okay? So, I think the goal though is not to just have this germane and generic and vanilla or chocolate, you know, I think that it needs to be, it definitely needs to be diverse with people who do have the time. And that's probably going to be very difficult because the younger individuals have other commitments, they have children, they, you know, may be taking care of aging parents or whatever. And so it's definitely something that we're going to have to put some deliberative thought into the computation of the board and who's on it and what they bring.
So Angela, let me, I agree. I think the board should be reflective of the community. I'm gonna pivot to another question that Angela and I went and reviewed these questions. We decided that this one was probably the right for me to ask. and you'll understand why. Sarah asked, and I think it's a really great question. As a white woman, I understand that racism exists both implicitly and explicitly in all white people. How are you helping our white police officers to in the community? And maybe you could talk about the implicit bias training that you all do at the in the force.
So you broke up a little bit, but oh, I think sorry. I got the gist of it.
Can you talk about the implicit bias training to address what are biases amongst your white officers and others?
Well, it starts with recruiting first, okay, before you get into training and all that other stuff, okay? Training's fine. Training will not change hearts, okay? We got body-worn cameras throughout most police departments, and you still see officers under conflict doing what they shouldn't be doing, okay? Training is necessary. And it's important, but under conflict, you're going to be who you are. And I think body-worn camera footage the last 4 or 5 years has certainly shown that. So we want to start by recruiting the right people. And what we do is we do a deep dive into their background. These young kids nowadays, you know, they are all over social media and they don't know. They say some things that will preclude them from becoming police officers. We see we have seen some white and black kids say some things that we couldn't hire them, okay? We could not hire them. So we are very, very acutely aware of the challenges when you hire, not so much in the past, but we are now. And I think a lot of police departments are making sure you're hiring people that have education, because education shows that you've generally been exposed to other folks other than your kind. You generally deal with conflict a lot better. You generally, you know, give people an opportunity to express themselves through procedural justice. You know, we train procedural justice. What is procedural justice? You stop an individual, tell them why you're stopping them, give them an opportunity to explain themselves. If there's an opportunity that exists that they get that second or third chance, give them that chance, but make them understand that they're getting a break. And if you happen to run into them again, you know, they understand when the time comes that you were true to your word, but when the time comes to make that arrest, generally, if you have to make that arrest, it's without conflict. So we do a lot of training through procedural justice, implicit bias. We had our whole police department trained by Dr. Lori Fidel. And at the time, she was the expert throughout the nation in training folks about their implicit biases and things of that nature. And I saw some utility to it, but I'll say this and I'll say it again. It starts with recruiting the right people with the right heart first, because training's fine, training's necessary, but I will say this and I'll say it again. You are going to show me who you are under conflict. And we put these students, or these recruits, in a lot of conflict throughout the police department when they're training. We do various scenarios trying to bring that true DNA to the surface, okay? And there's times you can tell, okay? There's opportunities to weed out some folks, and we have weed out some folks just because of that. So we do a lot of work going into these police academies and making sure that we get the right people. And we don't always get them all, but we get most of them correct. And the ones that aren't a perfect fit, they have to do something else.
Chief, I have a question as it relates to something that you said, because so I'm listening to what you're saying and I'm kind of hearing a catch 22 in that you talk to the officers about giving folks a second or third chance, right? Like you got your third chance. My pastor will say, you know, with the Lord, I'm on my fifth, second chance, right? So you talk, about giving, you know, folks a second chance. So how does that work with, I mean, I know that I'm thankful that social media was not as rampant as it is now when I was younger. So, and I'm sure there are a lot of us that feel that very same way. We would have done something, posted something stupid. And as you get older and you grow up and you realize, you know, that was stupid and you may have even forgotten about it. So how does that person who made a mistake in terms of a very bad post or something that they said on social media, how can they get an opportunity to show their growth and their, as we grow, we mature in our opinions of things as life kind of happens to us? Is there an opportunity for someone to overcome that? Or are you talking about things that are just so egregious that it's like, I don't think we want to take a chance at all?
Very good question. So there's two types of mistakes, mistake of the head and mistake of the heart. Okay. That mistake of the heart, I will never give you another chance because it's so egregious and you knew better. The mistakes of the head, absolutely. We give folks an opportunity to redeem themselves. Because again, I would be a hypocrite if I said anything differently. And there have been some policemen that we went back and forth on hiring. Maybe we should, maybe we shouldn't. Let's give them a chance. And they've been subpar. Okay. They've been really, really good. And then there's been some the opposite way. So, you know, you got to give folks a chance. And you got to give them an opportunity to develop and show who they are. But for the most part, you know, those that we give a chance, and they've shown since that, whatever the event is, they've highlighted and done different things to show that they have grown mentally and that they're not apt to do the same thing again. And every academy have one or two individuals that we give a chance to, and for the most part, it works out.
Hey, Chief. Hang on, Andrea, because I want to ask him one more question as it pertains to, we just decrimmed marijuana. So how does that play in hiring of police officers and the whole drug testing thing and all that? That really just came to my head as you were, you know, as you were talking.
Sure, sure. I got to tell you, that's never played a large role in our hiring process. Let me clean that up. we have folks that have used and we hire, okay? In this generation, you'd be hard pressed to find any that hadn't tried. Now, if you're Bob Marley, we're just not going to take you, okay? Okay. And we have had some Bob Marley types, you know, in terms of their activity, you know, and they were honest, you know, yeah, I smoked every day for 4 or 5 years, you know. So we're just not going to take you. But, you know, we've changed that philosophy, and it's not just us, it's throughout the nation. We've modified some of our standards to a degree, whether it's beards, tattoos, credit scores, marijuana use. We've modified some of that throughout the years to get people in the door. What you'll find with a lot of those folks, though, that are in that category, they're well educated, and a lot of them turn out to be pretty good policemen. But to answer your question, you know, if you sample or you went through a time in your life where you've used marijuana, you know, here and there, and you passed the polygraph based on that question, we will accept you. But if you have extensive use to the point that you could have been engaged in distribution, we won't. And that has happened.
So Chief, that was a good question, Angela. Chief, you mentioned people's true selves coming through even while body cam footage was being shot. So we had a couple questions about body cam footage specifically. So Ronnie asked, are police required to wear body cams? And if so, how do you ensure that they're on and recording? And Travis asked, would the citizens of the panel actually be able to review that film, and how frequently?
Okay, so there's two questions in there, obviously. So the body worn camera footage, we have a policy surrounding how officers will operate their body worn camera. They are required to turn their body worn camera on all calls, and they are required to keep it on until the call is completed. Now, early on in 2014, because we started purchasing these in 2014, right after the Ferguson event. And we started out with 300, and then we worked our way up to 400, and council was nice enough to continue to funding that program that we're now in the 540, 580 range. And as you guys know better than I know, they're very expensive.
Right.
But most of our officers have a body-worn camera. So the point I was going to make, in the very beginning, they were forgetting to turn it on. And one of the dispatchers started helping by saying, activate your body-worn camera. So when an officer got a call, that was the first thing the dispatcher said. And the last thing she said before the officer got out the car. And that helped trigger that thinking that I got to turn this on. And now it's automatic. Now, you know, we have disciplined some officers for not turning it on in a timely fashion. They turn it on, but they didn't turn it on in the very beginning. And the way it works, the first infraction is command counseling. All that is training. And the second infraction is a letter of reprimand. And the next infraction would be suspension time and so forth and so on. The other piece of that question, will citizens on the panel be allowed to look at the body-worn camera footage? And that's going to depend on the type of model we put together, okay? You have that investigative model that has a lot of teeth, okay? They have all 32, and they run independent, and they have access to everything, subpoena power, things of that nature. Then you have the advisory panel, which is more of a citizen oversight that reports out to the community on an incident. And then you have that third model, which is an audit collaborative model which is a blend of the police department and the advisory panel. I would suspect in all three models, a citizen would have the opportunity to watch the film. As of how frequently, I don't know if you need to see it every month. I mean, once you've seen it, you've seen it. But, you know, it would only make sense to me if you're going to have an oversight review panel and there's body-worn camera footage involved in a complaint, you got to show it.
And can you explain to people what happens if there's an officer involved? Can you hear me?
I can now.
Okay, sir. Can you explain what our policy is if there's an officer involved shooting and the body worn camera footage?
So the way it works, if there's an officer involved shooting, we contact the state police to do the investigation. Okay. We maintain the evidence until they get there. And once they arrive, they will take control of all the evidence to include the body-worn camera footage, okay? And they will do the investigation. Once the investigation is complete, they would forward it to the Commonwealth Attorney's Office for a recommendation. The body-worn camera footage is secured right away. And generally, that night, or the next day, I'll have an opportunity to take a look at the body-worn camera footage because I want to know, because I need to know. And from that point on, though, the housekeeping of said records and evidence is with the state police, and they'd subsequently turn it over to the Commonwealth Attorney's Office for a recommendation.
So, Chief, I think it's also important to note as well in the environment that we find ourselves in with, you know, 60-minute crime shows where the crime happens at the beginning, you get all the DNA and stuff and you get it processed. And at the end, at minute 58, right, that's when the whodunit happens and, you know, the whole crime is solved. And so I think it's important to note that this is not, you know, NCIS or CSI Miami or anything like that, or CSI Norfolk, that these investigations do take time. And I think that is important for a couple of reasons. Number one, we don't want to be quick to indict an officer and ruin their careers if they were acting properly. Number two, if there's there's also the justice for the family member that needs to happen. And if it were me and my family, I would want to make sure that everybody did everything that they were supposed to do. They didn't just rush to get a verdict or to get a bad guy, so to speak, in 30 minutes or in a week or whatever the case may be. So typically, how long does an investigation take, or how long can an investigation take with regard, especially with regard to an officer involved shooting? Because those are usually the ones that are, you know, the hot topics.
Well, it depends on what's going on. I can tell you right now, we have one currently in investigation. There's other cities that currently have one or two in investigation. And this COVID-19 had really slowed them up, more so than it would typically slow them up. But anywhere between 6 to 7, 8 months generally is a good timeline to ensure due process on the part of the officer, because we never want to avert an officer from realizing due process unless it's a George Floyd type incident. You know, that type of thing is so criminal that you don't need an investigation to make a decision. I'm talking about for me as a police chief, mm-hmm. All right, with respect to discipline. But, you know, most times these require due diligence on the part of the investigative body, and the officer should be afforded due process. And generally it takes about 6 to 8 months before a decision is rendered, and that's when we're able to make certain type of evidence available. There are times where there's an officer involved shooting where I'll try to get out front of it and say as much as I can say about it at the onset, particularly if there's rumors that, you know, the person hands were up or they had a gun or didn't have a gun. Some of the things that are so clear and obvious, particularly by the folks that were there and what the body-worn camera says, you want to get out in front of those things and try to, you know, quell some of the rumors, because if you don't, you never know what the outcome may be. So I'll generally try to get out in front of those and say as much as I can without one impugning the officer or the suspect.
Well, you know, Chief, I think you and I have had this conversation before, and, you know, I really admire the way that you handle, you know, situations, and respect the way that you handle situations and trust your judgment. But I think I've said to you before, I trust your judgment. I don't trust the judgment of every single body you got on that police force, right? So how do you, this is a good question. This is kind of a good segue to lead to a question from Nick, who is a Facebook friend of mine, actually, and I think he just got a promotion too on his job. But he said, this is Nick speaking to you. You've asked me on multiple occasions, where is the disconnect? What are we missing? And my team always gave you a plethora of examples. Yet I can't remember specifically asking you the same question. So where do you, Chief Boone, think there is a disconnect, and what do you think is missing? Because there's the historical piece, and this is my alliteration now, but there's a historical piece of mistrust, and rightfully so. I mean, we saw some of that stuff with the congressman who just died, and a lot of his beating up came at the hands of the police, right? So how do we kind of get, I don't want to say get over it, but how do we work through that? And what do you see as the disconnect to get to a place where we can start building some trust in the Black community, you know, with and I say the Black community because I don't know what it's like to be white. So what do we do?
I think we gotta have a difficult conversation, and we gotta let people speak their truth, no matter how uncomfortable it may be for you or the next guy. You gotta let our Caucasian brothers and sisters speak their truth without anybody pointing fingers, okay? Mm-hmm. And once everybody had an opportunity to speak their truth, we have to do something which we can hang our hat on. We spend a lot of time, as Congressman Bobby Scott says, celebrating the problem. We do an awful lot of talking. I've met with several groups, and we put plans together, and it falls by the wayside. To answer Nick's question, you know, what are we missing? From my perspective, we don't follow through. We just don't follow through. I've met with so many young men, African American for the most part, about plans and things we can do to reduce gun violence, things we can do to uplift our community, and we just don't follow through with our commitments. For whatever reasons, we go sideways, which is why, you know, there was a question I read earlier, you know, how can citizens get more involved in the community? You know, I'll meet with anyone, but if you meet with me, I'm going to put you to work, because it's not just on police, okay? You know, it's not just on the police. I'm going to put you to work where I see the best fit for you, you know, and I appreciate Nick. I met with Nick, and I forget the other gentleman's name, one day in my office shortly after some of the protests, because I was monitoring the protests, and I was eardropping, so to speak, on his Facebook Live page, and he was very fair, and I wanted to meet with him, and I had one of my officers reach out to him, and I met with him and another young man in my office, and, you know, I think we got to work together The police need the community. The community needs the police. We have to have difficult conversation. There's a piece that we don't talk about. We never talk about, but we got to have that conversation. You know, the police is connected to this ecosystem, and that ecosystem involves schooling, employment, health, poverty, and a lot of those safety nets are starting to fizzle away. And guess who's at the bottom trying to manage all that, to include mental health, okay? The young folks that were in the streets airing their grievances, yeah, police issues, that's out there, okay? But I gotta tell you folks, historically, if you look at the big picture, it's not just police. It's a whole lot of things that folks aren't able to realize because of some systematic practices that still exist today. And I said,
right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Angela, I think this is where you say that the city council should pass a resolution saying that systemic racism is a public health issue.
Absolutely. This is where the city council should pass a resolution declaring racism as a public health crisis in the city of Norfolk. Absolutely.
You and I are on the same page there.
Absolutely.
Because when you look at that map that the city created, the poverty map, mm-hmm. and you look at the health map that Sentara created for folks that are greatly impacted by cancer, high blood pressure, and everything else, diabetes, and you look at our crime map, and you look at our gun map, okay, and we're starting to track where we pick up those suffering from mental health issues. We're starting to map that, the police department is. I guarantee you, all those maps will interface nicely. They already do, okay? And we hadn't even completed the mental health map, and I guarantee you it will fit nicely into existing, which indicates, okay, we aren't that clever. Something exists to make this happen.
Right.
Okay. Something exists that funnels all this stuff to one neighborhood or one community, and the police department is left to deal with it. That isn't fair, folks. That isn't fair.
So this is that's a great segue to a question we had from Bonnie, who asked, how is your staff trained to deal with those who are experiencing homelessness or mental health issues, and how would you recommend or see us maybe evolving in the future?
So I said something in the papers a couple of weeks ago, and everybody, you know, how did she use the word defund? And I did. I used the word
defund. We ain't doing that. We ain't doing that, Chief. We ain't doing that.
Let me explain what it is first, okay? It's simply minimizing our footprint in some of those areas that I just spoke about, okay? I think if you want real police reform, you got to lighten the load on the police, all right? Yeah. We do a lot of interfacing with those suffering from mental psychosis. We got to get out of the habit of sending guns and badges to folks that are suffering, all right? We need to find a new model, and I think we're working on that right now, okay? But that model cannot be driven and led by the police. We got to stop that practice, because if you look at police shootings across the country, 20% of them involve folks suffering from a mental psychosis. We got to do something different. We got to do something different. Our officers are trained in CIT for crisis intervention. But at the same time, you know, we got to start identifying folks that live in those communities that may not have been taking their medicine. And we got to catch up. We got to do a better job of managing these folks. I was driving down Virginia Beach Boulevard, you know, today, and I saw a man out there that was in need of some assistance. And we all know where these communities are. You know, we talk about these things. I can go back to Rodney King. I can go back to Ferguson, Eric Gardner, and everything else in between to current day. And I can go beyond that. I just went back 30 years because that's my police experience. We talk about the same stuff, all right, every decade. When are we going to start realizing, other than police reform, some true outcomes? Because it's easy to say, let's focus on police reforms. It's necessary, okay? We have to do that. I'll be the first to say that. But we have to do some other things, too, that require the police to go into these communities to do some things that they aren't necessarily the best equipped to deal with.
Well, you know what, Chief, I think it goes back to something else that you said earlier about follow through, and people come up with, I heard this pastor teach, speak this lesson in that sometimes we want like a microwave God when what we really need is a crock pot. We want a microwave blessing when what we really need is a crock pot blessing. The blessing got to come together. And so what I'm hearing is that in the lack of follow through that you mentioned earlier, people sometimes want a microwave solution, and they want it flashy and sexy, and they want to get credit for it, and they want awards for it and all of that. But that stuff takes work, and that's the crock pot part, right? So again, like with this police, you know, the Citizens Advisory Board, I'm all for it. I'm not going to be on it, but I'm all for it. And the people who are going to be on it are going to have to realize that it is a commitment. It's a time commitment, and it is a crock pot type of commitment. There may be some things that you can easily microwave and fix, but there's a crock pot, you know, part of this as well that will bring the whole meal together. And so I think when you talk about why we're still having these conversations is because people get into these roles, or they get into, you know, they want to start this group or that group or the other group, and they realize, oh my God, this is hard. This is hard work. And I got to volunteer, and I'm not getting paid, and it's really a lot. I know that I think it was you, or it might have been Mike Goldsmith when he was chief. You guys had like a pastor's intervention, something or another, where you had pastors that would go out some evenings with the police department or with different people. Are they still doing that, or has that kind of fallen through the cracks?
No, COVID-19 has slowed it up. Again, you know, I'll meet with anyone. You know, I watched Mike Goldsmith meet with the clergy. And right here in the room that I'm in, it holds about 20, 25 people. And they ask Mike, what can we do to support you? And Mike said, well, stand next to me when the time comes. Well, that's not enough for me. Okay, so when they met with me, what can we do to support you? I always have an idea in my head. And I said, well, I want to start a clergy patrol. Let me tell you what that looks like. You will patrol Friday and Saturday nights from 8 to 12 in an area just outside of your church. It gives you an opportunity to provide counsel or speak to someone that may be a member of your church or may have a relative that's a member of your church. And what a dynamic opportunity it is to see for you to be with law enforcement and you to be with law enforcement in under that setting. Now, it started out a little slow, but I got to tell you, they stuck by their word, all right? And if it wasn't for the virus, we would still be rolling. So I got a lot of folks that are well-connected, and they're doing their part. You know, they're doing their part. And you know, that's a program that's been highlighted internationally and nationally, and we got other departments that are trying to do that as well. So again, seeing it through, have a plan, let's see it through. Too many of our forefathers have gone through way too much for folks not to be dedicated to have some measurable outcome, okay? Mm-hmm. You know, if you can measure it, you can fix it. And right. I think we're at a point now where, you know, there's a lot of things we can measure, but I don't know if we, you know, are where we need to be to go in there and do the heavy lifting just yet. So, and if we don't, you know, there'll be another George Floyd incident, and we'll never get to those social nets that I've highlighted earlier that have now broken, and who's at the bottom of that net trying to manage all that. Okay, we got to get beyond that, folks, and if not, somebody else will be sitting here 10 years saying the same thing.
So, Chief, I have to say, just call out that the mayor did stand up a commission on social equity and economic opportunity, and we haven't yet met. We'll plan a meeting in September, but I hope we have those outcomes that you mentioned. You can measure it. Yep. But it gets to the point, which is it's beyond just police reform, right? It is about if people don't have access to jobs, access to quality education and housing and public transit, you know, it's all part of the puzzle, and we've got to tackle it holistically. So
I'm so happy to hear you say that.
Absolutely. So we're at 1:01, and I promised y'all we weren't going to be here till 9:30. I've got a couple of questions. I just want to make sure that we acknowledge and address specifically. Philip asked about you supporting the creation of a citizen review board, and should this group have administrative power? You answered that question in our conversation. Marsha, now this one I don't think we talked about. Is the why won't Norfolk go back more than 10 years in reviewing the police of force? And I think I know the answer, but I'll let you answer that question. I think we talked about the time frame. So what is like the time frame that we're possibly looking at?
So the Library of Virginia gives you windows of which you shall keep things in your possession, and then the deadline in which you can shred, get rid of, or whatever the case may be. And we simply follow that policy. 5 years is the window. However, if there is a use of force involving discipline, or someone is suing the city, something of that ilk, we maintain those, okay? We maintain those because we want to have an accurate picture of one in case litigation comes, we have something tangible, or when the time comes for someone to challenge a discipline or someone to come back and look at an officer's personnel file, we'll have that on hand. You know, I cannot tell you how many times we fired officers and that officer went to another agency, and I was surprised that agency did not come and look at that officer's personnel record.
That's something that hopefully the State General Assembly might be addressing in the criminal justice reform, creating a database where something like that would exist.
I think that's going to be something that is going to be solidified, because currently, if I was to terminate an officer for excessive force, they can go somewhere else, because that's not one of the automatic disqualifiers with respect to certification.
Well, you know, it's kind of like doctors. They can kill somebody in Virginia and go get hired in New York. So, I mean, it's just crazy. And then the last question from Amina is talking about a database as well. Can a database be developed where citizens can document bad police behavior? Can we be more vigilant in preventing unnecessary police contact with people of color? And I'm gonna figure that she's talking about racial profiling. And then she asked a question about training, but she referenced something that we were not able to verify. So I'm gonna leave that part of the question out. But I think we talked a little bit about database, but then how do we, I guess that goes to that bias training of making sure that we don't have that unnecessary, you look the part, you know, kind of deal for absolutely no reason at all when it comes to interactions with Black folks, and probably especially Black men more so than Black women.
So the question is, can we establish a database where a citizen can report bad behavior?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so let me take a stab at it this way. We currently have a process where citizens can report bad behavior, whether that's making a report through OPS, our Office of Professional Standards, better known as IED, or they could email that complaint through our portal, a web portal, or they can mail the complaint in. There's various ways one can make a complaint, if there's four to be exact. But if she's talking about a database, and I think this is what she's talking about, a database that exists where a citizen can go into and look up, let's say Officer X, and Officer X, this is his discipline history. That doesn't exist right now. I know there is conversation surrounding giving an officer an ID number, and you're able to look up that officer's discipline history. Currently in our organization, you know, when we do our monthly discipline sheet, we put out information, officer so-and-so, we don't mention by name, we just say officer did this, this is the discipline that they received. But, you know, being internal, most of the folks can figure it out who it is. But right now, there is not a database that exists where a citizen can go look up an officer's discipline history, but I suspect that's coming. I don't embrace the idea of putting an officer's name on this database because I can tell you, you know, there are some folks out there that will make it difficult for the officer, particularly if, you know, the officer has two or three complaints that may be substantiated and people not understanding, you know, what was all involved in that particular complaint. What was the other part? Because
I just want to, you know, I want to comment on that because, you know, my belief is that, you know, there are not many jobs where people carry weapons like a gun, a billy club, a taser, and all that, and have the power. As we started this conversation, we started talking about the power that a police officer has. And so I agree with you in that I do believe that the officers and for the name of the officer, because so many times one of the complaints that we hear, and whether it's an exaggeration of the truth or whether it is in fact the truth, trying to get an officer to give you their name and badge number sometime can be like pulling teeth with some out of somebody with no Novocaine, right? They're not in certain situations, they have not been in the past so readily, I've heard, easily to give that information out. So if there is a database, I'm gonna put all the qualifiers out there. If there is a database where someone can either make a complaint or they can look up and see, because I go back to, I think the officer Chavez that killed George Floyd, you know, he had like 18 freaking complaints. And that's just crazy to me that somebody could still be on the force and have, you know, that many. And I just can't believe that all 18 of them were unfounded. And if all 18 of them were unfounded, how many of them were actually founded? So I just, you know, I know you want to give the officers the benefit of the doubt, but sometimes they deserve it and sometimes they don't. So we just want to make sure that we protect the public from those that are designed to protect and serve us and make sure that they are protecting and serving us. The other part of the question was, she talked about training and, you're talking about, okay, how can we be vigilant in preventing unnecessary police contact with people of color? And I'm going to figure she's talking about racial profiling.
Well, I think that's part of it, but I think the other part of it is we need to take care of those social ills that I spoke about earlier that require the police to go to some of these communities 90% of the time. If we address, okay, the elephant in the room, we can greatly minimize the footprint and the scope of our responsibilities, which is why when I use the fund, the term defund, I'm talking about getting us away from dealing with so many mental health individuals. You know, I looked at the data for the last 6 months. We had about 290 calls in which my officers were dealing with that. And when you look at the manpower hours, we're talking about 1,300 hours of manpower dedicated just this past 6 months. And I'm missing some of that information. I'm missing 2 months of that data from one particular precinct. But, you know, that's huge. That's huge. There's been incidents where my officers, you know, were detailed for 24 hours. With an individual that was going through a mental psychosis, you know. So we, to minimize that footprint, we got to look at poverty. We got to look at crime. We got to look at mental health. We got to look at, you know, all those things that, you know, police were used for back in the day as agents of social control. We got to get away from that. That's a mouthful.
Right. All right. Well, it is 10 after 8. I'm going to let Andrea have closing remarks. Chief, you can have your closing remarks, and then I'll come back and close us out.
I just want to say thank you for, first of all, for all the folks who tuned in, for your patience. We had a little rocky start thanks to technology. Mm-hmm. I'm glad that I see this is being recorded, so I'm sure the city will post it someplace. But this is unlike any... somebody said the other day, Chief and I were on another webinar. This is a once in a 50-year time period right now. There is a realization by people who look like you, Angela, and people who look like me, that we got to work together, and there's something very wrong. And there's something that's been very wrong. Mm-hmm. But now we're actually talking about it, and we're having difficult conversations, as Chief mentioned. And if we don't take this moment and make it a movement and do something, to the chief's point, and more than just talk about it, shame on us. So I do appreciate the conversation, and thank you for your candor from both of you. And I'm proud to call you colleagues. So I'll let the chief take it from here.
Well, I want to thank you both for allowing me to speak tonight. I do apologize for the hiccups the first 10 to 20 minutes. That hadn't happened in the past, but I think we're able to recover. You know, as I look at the current moment that we're in, you know, we got one opportunity to fix this, okay? We really do, because all the energy that has gone into the last 4 to 5 to 6 weeks, I don't know how we look at ourselves in the mirror and pretend we didn't have these discussions, okay, because we have. I can tell you one particular protest, I went out into the crowd, and those young folks, black, white, you know, LGBTQ, they were serious folks. They were serious, and a lot of them was extremely passionate about this moment, okay, and all of them weren't friendly, okay, but most of them were. And, you know, listening to them, I was pleased at their energy, okay? Because any change that's ever occurred in this country occurred with young people. Young people. When you think of Dr. Martin Luther King and John Lewis, they were young, early 20s, okay? They pushed that change. And this group of kids, you know, we talk about America being the melting pot. Every March, that's what you saw. That's what you saw, you know, and we are going to continue, as long as they're peaceful, to exercise their grievances, their First Amendment rights, without any interference. And I hope through all this discussion, again, I hope we have some things that we can say we've done, and we've done it right, because everybody's watching. Everybody's watching, and we got one shot to get this right. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief, and thank you, Andrea, for tonight, and thank you again to everyone who has been with us for the duration, and to everyone who will watch this, to everybody who sent us in questions. We really appreciate the time that you took to do that. And so I want to say that the police you all do a very difficult job. And that is not lost on me. I hope it is not lost on the community. You all deal with very bad people who have committed very bad crimes. And you can't always be officer friendly when you're dealing with someone who is a very bad person. And I will tell you that I spent a little bit of time working at the sheriff's office and had the benefit of reading some folks' records. And some of the stuff that's on these records that people have been convicted of, it will scare you. And you can look at folks and go, they're that bad? But in situations where lives are at stake and you're looking to solve a crime, or you're looking to catch someone or apprehend a suspect and make sure that our community is safe from very bad people, you guys have a hard job. And so one of the things we kind of talked about a little bit in our last council meeting was about everything kind of does get dumped on the police. If you can't fix it, let's let the police handle it. If you can't, you know, find a solution to it, we'll just call the police and let them lock them up. And it's time out for all of that, and that we take some different routes to doing some things. This session will post on the city's YouTube channel. It will run again, I think, it'll be available on my personal social media channel. And so anybody who missed it can see it there as well. And so I just want to again take the opportunity to thank you. And I agree with you, Chief. We do have an opportunity. We do have a moment in time. I appreciate the respect that you and your team have offered to our peaceful protesters, as well as the respect that the peaceful protesters have offered to you and to your team. But we do have to make a difference, and we do have to do something different so that we are not having this same conversation 5 years from now, 6 years from now, 7 years from now. We will have a different conversation, and we'll be talking about the additional things that we've done and the advancements that we've made and how we changed the needle and how we have changed other people's lives. Chief, keep telling your story. You are an inspiration to so many young people. You really are. And you are an inspiration to little brown boys and little brown girls who maybe feel hopeless, and they don't see a me. They don't see a you. And so when they hear your story, they know that they can become more than what they might see in their everyday life. So thank you to all the PR and media people that made this happen, Melissa, and to the PR people over at the police department. Thank you so much for getting us up and running. Thank you all for your time. Be safe, be healthy, and be blessed. Thank you. Good night.
All right.